Hey there, my name is Vincent, creator of Infohazard Games, and I'm making an FPS called Astral Horizon. This video is the follow-up to my first devlog, so go check that out if you haven't already. Or, you know, don't. I'm not telling you what to watch. In this video, I'll talk about how I built my new and improved 3D navigation system. So to recap, in Astral Horizon, characters can fly around in all three dimensions, which means I need some sort of 3D navigation system beyond a surface-based nav mesh. My initial solution involved splitting up the level into a grid or octree with cells that were either open or blocked. That solution worked pretty well, but it had some issues that I covered in the last video. This year, I set out to do better, so let's jump right in. My initial idea going into the project was to take the same technique used to generate a nav mesh and pull it into three dimensions. Now, because most game engines have a standardized nav mesh solution, there isn't actually much information on implementing them on the internet. However, I was able to find this one super helpful set of lecture slides that cover an algorithm called Recast that seems to do the trick. So the basic idea in Recast is to start by voxelizing the walkable surfaces using a pretty small voxel size. Next, for each valid walkable voxel, calculate the distance from the nearest edge of the walkable surface. We can envision these distances as an inverted height map, with voxels further from the edge being lower. We'll refer to the local minima of this height map as basins. With the analogy of the height map as real-life terrain, we can imagine rainwater filling these basins and forming lakes. We'll slowly increase the water level in each lake until it meets the water of another lake. We keep doing this until the map is completely covered in water. This part of the algorithm is called watershed partitioning, and it gives us regions that don't contain any holes. With those regions calculated, we can convert them to polygons, simplify by removing excess points, and finally triangulate to get our nav mesh. With a decent understanding of how this algorithm works in 2D, I set out to do the same thing in 3D. The voxelization and watershed steps went pretty smoothly, since voxel manipulation is easily converted to a higher dimension. But going from voxels to a mesh was a much bigger challenge. The 3D equivalent of this step in Recast would be turning the voxels into a polyhedron, then breaking that into tetrahedrons, which would make up the 3D navmesh-like thing. Okay, so I hit a blocker. This thing needed a name. Mathematicians sometimes use the hyper prefix when naming the equivalent of a shape in a higher dimension. A cube becomes a hypercube in 4D, for example. So I thought HyperNav would be a fitting name, in addition to sounding pretty cool. Anyway, back to generating meshes from voxels. I wanted the meshes to look less blocky and support 45-degree angles, so I went with an algorithm called marching cubes. Marching cubes looks at cells of 8 adjacent voxels, each of which can be either on or off. The exact configuration of those 8 voxels is mapped to a cube index, which gives back a set of triangles to add to the mesh. You can learn more about marching cubes in Sebastian Legg's excellent video linked here. With these meshes built, I definitely needed to get rid of all these unnecessary vertices. The code for this was pretty complex and really made me appreciate something that's so easy to do in a modeling program like Blender. Now, with the polyhedral regions built, it was time to decompose them into tetrahedra to build my HyperNav mesh. Unfortunately, I couldn't find anything helpful about the subject online, so I decided to just mess around in Blender and see if I could come up with an algorithm that made sense. I could not. What I realized, however, is that tetrahedral decomposition might not be ideal anyway. I would probably end up with a bunch of really long and narrow tetrahedra, which would make poor pathfinding nodes. Plus, while nav meshes do often use triangles for their nodes, it's not strictly necessary. All that matters is that there's a guaranteed path from any point in the shape to any other point. This is true not just for triangles, but for any convex polygon. Similarly, in 3D, this is also true for any convex polyhedron. So, I didn't really need to decompose regions into tetrahedra, just making them convex would be sufficient. However, at this point in the algorithm, that didn't actually make things any easier. While there's been plenty of research into concave mesh decomposition, it's definitely a non-trivial task and there's no perfect solution. It would be way easier if I could just make sure the voxel regions were all convex before applying marching cubes, then not worry about it after. To get the correct results, I needed to predict where marching cubes would create concavities. There are two situations that can create concavities, either a single 8-voxel cell or two adjacent cells placed in a certain configuration. I built up a list of all of these possible combinations ahead of time so that I could loop through each cell in neighbor pair to find all the places where concavities occur. I then split the region into two at each of these points in order to get several smaller convex regions. This process was successful in ensuring the output of marching cubes was convex, but it did create some messy small regions that I wanted to fix. I realized that with this convexification step, I really didn't need the watershed algorithm anymore. It would only create splits that might not be needed to ensure convexity. So I removed that step, relying on the convexify step to remove any holes as well. I also added a step right after convexification in order to merge any two adjacent regions which would combine into a convex region. This merge step, while pretty heavy on processing cost, did manage to reduce the number of regions by up to 25%. I was able to make the convexify and merge steps a lot faster by running them in multiple threads using C# async task system via task.run. With those changes, I now had a pretty clean set of convex regions, so it was actually time to use those as nodes for pathfinding. Of course, it goes without saying that there were some challenges here as well. In a nav mesh, we can use the shared edges between triangles as the connections in a graph. So in a hypernav mesh, it stands to reason that I'd use shared faces. However, because of how marching cubes works, some adjacent regions don't end up having shared faces. Therefore, I had to consider shared edges and shared vertices to also be valid connections between regions. Additionally, the large size of regions could create issues for the pathfinding algorithm. Even if two regions share a face, there may not be a clear straight path between the region's centers. The shortest path through a region may also not go anywhere near its center, but rather just cross through the edge. It turns out that while regions easily map to the concept of nodes, it's equally valid to consider the connections between the regions to be the actual graph nodes. This actually ended up working better and solved both of the previously mentioned issues. Once the shortest path through the graph was calculated, I wanted to see if I could simplify it further. Often, stopping through a bunch of nodes will result in a path with a lot of unnecessary waypoints. If you can trace a straight, clear line from the first point in a path to the 10th point, you should be able to get rid of points 1 through 9, right? Yes, actually, that's not a trick question. With the volume mesh data I already had, I added a raycast check between pairs of points on a line to remove the unneeded ones. I also mentioned in my previous video that the performance in my old system was sometimes less than spectacular. If a bunch of characters need to find complex paths at the same time, the system would need to be as fast as it possibly could be. To achieve this, I decided to finally explore Unity's data-oriented tech stack, or DOTS. Two important parts of DOTS are the C# job system, which facilitates fast multi-threaded code, and the burst compiler, which compiles your C# code to super-optimized native code, in order to squeeze out even more speed. These two systems are often used together to write multi-threaded code that runs
at extremely fast speeds.
It was a perfect fit for a task like pathfinding. Now, in order to work, Burst has to impose some pretty strict restraints on any code you use it with. You can't use any C# reference types, which means no classes, no Unity objects, and no standard C# collections, not even arrays. The volume data, which I store as a scriptable object, needed to be converted to a representation that only uses structs and Unity native collections. Now, you might be thinking that allocating memory and copying data for every pathfinding call sounds pretty expensive, but fortunately, the bulk of the data that I needed to pass to the job was just baked volume data, which doesn't change during runtime. I can just allocate and copy the data once, then pass it to the job in read-only mode. Some memory did need to be allocated per job, such as the output path and temporary data structures, but the allocation is quite fast compared to C# managed memory. Everything else, like the start location and destination, can be passed as structs, so they don't need any dynamic allocation. Now, in order to find a path, I could kick off a job, keep track of it on the managed side, and wait for the job to finish. I don't want too many jobs running in parallel, since that could potentially take resources away from the engine and slow down the rest of the game. So when a request is received, I just put it into a queue until there are fewer than the max number of jobs running. Looking at what I had at this point, I still wasn't quite happy with it yet. It had better performance and accuracy than the previous octree-based solution, but the actual flight paths that the characters take still look kind of, well, bad. If you were flying a jetpack along a path, you probably wouldn't move in straight lines as if you were flying between waypoints. You'd be more likely to fly along a curved path, slowing down around obstacles and sharp turns. I figured I could accomplish something similar using a spline. I started by calculating a spline that used the path waypoints as its control points with automatic tangents. At a character's current location, we can calculate the nearest position on this spline as well as the tangent. The tangent defines the direction they want to be moving in, and the position defines where they should be ideally right now. This gave me two vectors that influence the final desired velocity, moving towards the spline position and moving along the spline tangent. I mixed these vectors based on the distance from the spline point, so if characters veer way off the spline, they focus on trying to get back to it, and if they're near it, they focus on following its direction. It did seem to work pretty well already, but characters had trouble staying on the path at sharp turns. This makes intuitive sense if you've ever driven a car or played a racing game. If you take a sharp turn at full speed, you're gonna have a bad time. To have characters slow down during bends, I needed to know the spline curvature at their current location. Looking at the math of the spline, each segment is a three-component parametric cubic function, which we'll call f of t. The derivative, f prime of t, gives us the tangent of that function. Calculus tells us that the curvature of the function is given by its second derivative, f double prime of t. I initially tried doing some calculus to find the second derivative analytically, but that wasn't giving the results I wanted due to the non-constant relationship between the spline's parameter value and the actual distance. So I decided to go with the simpler numeric approach, just calculate the tangents at two nearby points, take the difference between them, and divide that by the distance between the points. This results in a curvature vector, which I can just take the length of to get a single curvature value. Now, I simply scale the desired velocity down based on this curvature, and it works surprisingly well. Not only does the slowing down at corners make the flight a bit more realistic, it also helps prevent the characters from veering off the path too much. With the spline-based movement, it was already looking a lot better, but I also wanted to make characters rotate in a more interesting way. Previously, I would just have them always face in the direction of their movement, which looks pretty unnatural. Now, this is all dependent on the animations being used, but I found that angling them so that their movement is between their up and forward vectors looks a lot better. Towards the end of the path, if they'll be landing on the ground, they should also rotate into the orientation they'll be landing in. Finally, I added a landing animation rather than having them transition directly from flight to standing. These minor changes actually made a huge difference, and I'm pretty happy with how stuff is looking now. If you watched my previous devlog, you may notice that one thing I haven't addressed yet is handling paths that include both flying and walking. I definitely still want to get to that, but I haven't gotten there yet. If I'm successful, I'll make another devlog on that in the future. So after watching this, if you think this navigation system might be helpful to you, but you don't want to write it all yourself, you're in luck! I've published HyperNav on the Unity Asset Store, and you can currently pick it up for half off. Also, if you're a student and want to use it for educational purposes, just drop me a message and I'd be more than happy to send you a free copy. I'll continue to improve the system and fix issues as I develop Astral Horizon further, and all those changes will be included. Anyway, that's all for this video! Stay tuned to learn more in future devlogs, and catch my Twitch streams if you want to follow development in real time. Bye for now!